Justice, again, esteemed brother and sister judges, respected retired judges, learned Advocate General, President of the Kerala High Court Advocates Association, respected senior lawyers, my dear junior lawyers, law officers of the state and central governments, Registrar General and other registrars, budding lawyers, good morning to all. There can be no better way to disseminate the objectives of the Law Institute than by spreading knowledge through lectures, seminars and other programs so as to meet the social, economical and other needs of the people. The aims of the Law Institute include cultivating the science of law, promotion of systematization of law, improving quality and the content of higher education law, imparting instructions in law, and publishing books, periodicals, etc. Conferences, seminars, workshops, lectures can provide a wealth of information on broad array of topics and professional issues. Lectures are probably the best teaching method in many circumstances, especially for communicating conceptual knowledge. Knowledge one gains from participating in seminars, lectures, play a key role in the development of his or her professional skills. It is with this objective in mind, Kerala State Unit has arranged this lecture, which is going to be delivered by Honorable Justice L.Nageswara, Judge, Supreme Court of India, on the topic, the freedom to express dissent, a jurisprudential approach. The topic selected has got great relevance in the current scenario, and I'm sure that the thought-provoking lecture on the subject would be extremely helpful to the judges and members of the legal fraternity. I'm proud to say that the State Kerala State Unit of the Indian Law Institute has been carrying out the objectives of the parent institute in letter and spirit effectively. I hope that the active support and participation of all those connected with this institution, the endeavors of Kerala Unit of the Indian Law Institute, will find a place in the Indian judicial system worth emulating by other high courts, thereby paving the way for improvement of the system. As the President of the Indian Law Institute, Kerala State Unit, I convey my sincere thanks to Honorable Justice L.Nageswara for his kind gesture to deliver this lecture. Thank you.
We are indeed honored to have with us such an esteemed Chief Guest with a legal career growing practice in the High Court of Andhra Pradesh at Hyderabad for about 9 years to 1994, after which he began practicing at the Supreme Court of India. Justice Rao was designated as a senior advocate. Justice Rao was appointed as a judge of the Supreme Court of India. Promulgation of ordinances is unconstitutional. We won't keep you waiting any further. I hand over the stage to our chief guest, the Honorable Sri.Justice L.Nageswara Rao.
Chief Justice of the Kerala High Court, she's my mom. This is Jason Gunamia. The other sitting judges of the Kerala High Court, former judge of the Kerala High Court, learned Advocate General, former Advocate General, and senior advocates, other members of the bar, and Indian law students. And I would say they should apologize for being late, but this is due to unavoidable circumstances like I was late. So this is not in my hands. Still, I may be excused for being late. When This is Nambiya called me saying that there is a proposal to have a chapter in Kerala and revive it for the benefit of the lawyers and law students. And I was very happy, and I was in the, as in the executive committee of the ILA. And I thought that this is a very good step for spreading the learning of law, which is very required for law students and the lawyers. The Chief Justice, Justice Shafiq, Justice Nambiya, Justice Namun Sivaraman, Justice Alexander Thomas, who are in the executive committee, have to be congratulated for starting this initiative, and I'm sure that they'll take this forward by having many more lectures, many more seminars, many more group discussions on topics of law, which would benefit the legal fraternity. I have no doubt in my mind that all of you would definitely be benefited by the freedom of speech, which is expressed by the speakers, and also the dissent, which would come from you. The topic is dissent as a fundamental right and a jurisprudential approach. Initially, we have to understand what is the nature of this right of speech. The nature of the right can be seen in two parts. One is the instrumental part of the freedom of speech, and the second is the natural right, which is called the constitutional part. The instrumental part is this. There should be freedom of speech for every individual, not only for the benefit of developing himself, which is intrinsic in a person. And the other part, which has to be looked into, is the benefit which comes to the society by the freedom of speech that is given to a human being. If you are active in your speech, then that would be helpful for a participative democracy. Participative democracy is every individual being a part of the democracy. Every individual feeling that he is a part, not only of being ruled, but being one amongst the rulers. How do you do it? You have the government at the helm of affairs, and you're ruled by the government, though there are representatives, they are the ones who take the decisions. The decisions taken by them are for the benefit of the public, that is, every citizen in this country. So it is necessary that the voice of the citizens here has to be heard. Every voice is required to be heard by the government for the purpose of this participative democracy. Every individual in this country has to be recognized as a person who has the right to express his views and express his ideas for the betterment of the society, one. Two, for better organization of the society. And number three, for better governance by the government. Better governance by the government would be more meaningful only when the ideas that are expressed by individuals is taken into account by the government. So the institutional part of the freedom of speech is this, that benefit of freedom of speech is for the purpose of a better society. That is the institutional part. And the intrinsic part is this, that unless you think, you will not be able to speak. And unless you speak, your mental faculties will not grow. So the autonomy of an individual would be improved by better utilization of your mind and of your mouth by speaking. So this is the intrinsic part of the individual, of an individual, which is part of the fundamental of the right of speech of every individual. Now all of you know that we have unearned rights, and you have Article 19(1)(a), which protects your fundamental right of speech and expression, with certain reasonable restrictions that come in 19(2). The topic today is on dissent, so I will not go into the larger aspect of what this right is. So I have to touch upon this right for the purpose of telling you how important is dissent in a democracy. The restrictions that are placed in 19(2) are reasonable restrictions in the interest of, this is the language that is used in 19(2), in the interest of security of state, friendly relations with the other countries, your public order, and information, content, and incitement to an offense. These are the restrictions which can be placed by the government to curtail the right of speech of individuals in this country. Whenever somebody speaks of dissent, the others might be thinking that, oh, this person is not in the traditional mold of what the other people are saying. So he immediately is dubbed as a person who is not following in line with the majority. Dissent itself has to be understood as a decision and an idea that comes from an individual which is against an established norm of the society, which means the majority takes a view, and there are a few people who might not agree with the majority. So that is a dissent. Now, whether this dissent should be curtailed in a democracy is something which we will discuss today. In a democracy where deliberations are very important, apart from participation, there is a need for ideas to come into the marketplace, which is the theory of a marketplace, as they say. For the truth to come out, the ideas of other persons who take a different view also has to be tested. It might be false, I might have an idea which is actually not correct. But otherwise, unless this is tested, the truth would not come out. So that is a marketplace theory. I'll tell you how it has come. This, if you take the historical background of how this dissent has started, it was a long time back, you know, in 1501, when Pope Alexander in England, he issued an edict saying that anybody who criticizes the church would be tried and executed because they are non-believers in Christ. Then those were the days of Protestants being the majority in England in 1501. And thereafter, England had a history of having Star Chambers, which is a court which was trying only persons who were dissenting, showing disloyalty to the king and the church. Church was very, very important in those days, very powerful also. And then there was a law that was made when the press was initially invented in 1500, and books were being printed in England, that there should be licenses taken for every book that is printed and then sold in the market. Those were the days when John Milton wrote a letter to the Parliament, and that letter is known as Aeropagitica. And in that letter he says that you cannot ask for books to be printed and published only after a license is taken. that is putting a prior restraint on the freedom of speech. Unless you permit people to write and people to speak, then you would not understand what the public are saying. So the letter that he wrote to the parliament, initially was not taken very seriously, but later the fundamental right of speech, whenever it's talked about, there is a reference to this Aerobiodetica letter written by John Milton, where he was speaking of dissent being a very important facet of a right which inheres in a human being. I might have some feelings, but I should not hide them inside myself because I am afraid of what people could say. I might be right and the majority might be wrong. I should have the freedom to speak out and express my dissent. Blackstone, who was supposed to be an expert in common law and was followed in USA later when the Constitution was made and even the judgments that came out from the US Supreme Court which followed the common law principles, was also of the view that nobody should be permitted, nobody should be prohibited from speaking what they want, and even if it is not liked by the larger public, they should not stop him from doing it, which means that there cannot be any prior restraint on speech. What he propagated was, you don't ask people to take licenses if at all they wanted to start printing presses. He said no government can stop the press from publishing whatever they want. If at all they have violated the law as it existed then, they might be liable for some punishment. They might be liable for some damages. I use the word punishment because the Sedition Act was there in UK. I'll go to sedition a little later. But prior restraint was something which Blackstone said that should not be there. The government should not impose any restraints on any publication, or they should not stop people from speaking whatever they wanted to. In the US, the Sedition Act was made in 1798, 20 years after the Constitution was brought in, after the Declaration of Independence, which was about 20 years. This is Adams, President Adams. He said that whoever was going against him would be tried under the Sedition Act because showing disloyalty to him was showing disloyalty to the country. Thereafter, about 30, 40 years later, people against whom cases were being filed under the Sedition Act, they were all pardoned and then said that the Sedition Act is something which we cannot use because the First Amendment to the Constitution of India, of the USA, as well as the 14th Amendment, they give a right of speech to all individuals which cannot be curtailed by law. There is a question that has arisen before the Indian Supreme Court as to whether the right which is guaranteed to US citizens is an absolute right or not, because the right that is guaranteed to Indian citizens under the Constitution comes with some conditions and restrictions. So the Sedition Act, which is brought in 1798, was put to use in the First World War. There was a communist movement in the USA where there was a revolt that started amongst individuals who were saying that the USA should not fight a war with Russia. There were people who were saying that what the government was doing is wrong. A number of cases were tried by the US Supreme Court. Justice Holmes initially, who was a non-believer in giving the rights to individuals against government, wrote a judgment in Abrams, which is a dissent opinion of his, where he said that every person should be permitted to speak whatever he wants. And whatever he speaks has to be tested in the marketplace. He says unless different voices are heard in the marketplace, the truth will not come. That is the marketplace theory which started with the brands. And this theory, which was propagated by Justice Holmes, was tested later, and then the question was as to whether the court can start interfering in all cases where legislations are made when speech was curtailed in extreme conditions. The law that was laid down by the US Supreme Court was that a test called the clear and present danger test has to be followed for the purpose of finding out whether there is an interference that was warranted in legislations or executive orders that were passed curtailing the right of speech of an individual. Ultimately, even this test of clear and present danger was found to be wrong. These judgments were set aside in a case called Brandenburg versus Ahoy, where Justice Louis Brandeis, he came out with a theory called the imminent lawlessness theory test, which means what? That whenever there is a legislation or an executive action which curtails speech of an individual or individuals, and somebody comes in and says that I have a First Amendment right, so my speech is being curtailed by these orders, so you stop the executive from doing it, then the court would try to apply this test as to what is the nature of the speech, what would be the consequence of this speech, whether this is going to result in an imminent lawlessness action. That is the test that came out in this judgment of Brandenburg versus Ahoy. The case there in Brandenburg was this. I don't know whether you've heard about this Ku Klux Klan. There are people in USA who believe that the land belongs to them. And the blacks from Africa and the Jews from the other parts of the world, Israel, etc., have come and they've been making merry in USA. They want these people to go back. They say that blacks have to go back to Africa and then the Jews have to go back to Israel. So what they keep doing is they keep burning crosses in the precincts of blacks, etc. They have these hoods. On one fine evening, they called the press. They said, we're going to have a press conference. The number of reporters went there. And they made an announcement saying that we are reiterating our demand for blacks to leave USA and the Jews to also to leave USA. And if that is not done, we are all going to march to the capital. That was the announcement that they made. And they were all tried for seditious activities. The court had to take note of the earlier law where the government was trying to defend, saying that there is this clear and present danger to the harmony of the society, and that's the reason we are stopping these people from going on this demonstration, and they're trying to spread evil amongst the people. Then this test of what would be the consequence of what they were doing, whether this is going to lead to an imminent lawlessness theory, is what the court considered. So that's how the imminent lawlessness theory came, and which is still being followed from the 1930s, 40s onwards till date in the USA. Dissent, normally when you speak of, is the political dissent. Political dissent being either all of us are in politics. Political dissent pertains to the administration of the society, the well-being of the society. Whatever you're speaking of is on behalf of the society, or what is happening in the society. This is what is a political dissent about. But the thrust whenever you speak of political dissent would be whether you are criticizing the persons in authority, and what would be the result of your criticism against persons in power. That would be something which comes to mind. This sedition, which was part of an act in UK initially, was only for the purpose of protecting the king or the queen and the church. So anybody who says anything against your king would definitely be taken to task. So that's the reason why this act was there. So the voice of persons was stifled and the dissent was not heard at all. That was part of monarchies. And how did it all start in India? Macaulay was here, he made IPC, but in the IPC to start with, which was made by Macaulay, sedition is not there. Sedition was introduced by a gentleman called Fitz-James because he was asked to do so in view of the Wahhabi movement which was in existence then. This Wahhabi movement was a movement started by Muslims, mainly in Bihar, where they were supporting the Turks. And Wahhabis were slowly spreading in all parts of the country. They had their own organizations or branches in Hyderabad and various other places. It was gathering dust. So the colonial rulers thought that we will have to put a stop to this because this is against the queen. So that's how 124A of IBC was introduced. And 124A of the IPC wreaked havoc. The nationalist movement started. Most of the leaders who were fighting for freedom were tried under 124A. Initially, Tilak, for a speech made by him and for a book that was written by him. The first case of the speech made by him was in praise of Shivaji. And he made that speech where he said that Shivaji killed a Muslim leader. 4 or 5 days thereafter, there was an attempt on some officers of the British. They escaped and 3 persons were killed. So he was charged under 124A. And Muhammad Jinnah, who was a very renowned criminal lawyer, then who was practicing in Bombay, he argued for Tilak, and Tilak was sentenced to 6 years imprisonment. The interpretation of 124A IPC was done by a judge by the name Strachey, and that interpretation placed by him was known as the Strachey rule. The interpretation of 124A according to Strachey was this. He said, the interpretation doesn't have any connection with the consequences of the speech. Disloyalty, if at all, the rulers feel that whatever is spoken is out of ill will and disloyalty, that would be sufficient, is what Strachey said. Nothing to do with the consequences. Remember what I told you about the imminent lawlessness theory, which is already, which is there in the US. This judgment written by Strachey stood the field for a very long time, till it was reversed much later. After Tilak, there was another trial of Annie Besant. Annie Besant started a press in Madras, and she was asked to take a license. She said, why should I take a license for starting a press? Then they said, there's a requirement that you should take a license and you're not going to go into print without a license. And thereafter she violated the law and then started printing, and then there was a trial and she was also convicted under 124A. The most important case came when Mahatma Gandhi was tried in the 1920s. You must have heard about Champaran. Champaran failed. There was a lot of violence in Bombay as well as Champaran. Mahatma Gandhi withdrew the agitation that he started because you all know that he believed in non-violent methods. It was disliked by most of the leaders, including Jawaharlal Nehru. They thought that he was on the rise, and at that point of time, withdrawing the agitation was not good. That apart, Mahatma Gandhi was tried along with the owner of a newspaper called Young India, because he wrote an article in Young India. When he was called to the court, when he was asked as to whether you admit your guilt, he said, yes, I admit. Then the judge did not know what to do. The Advocate General from Bombay was flowing for this trial, flying at not having the certificate. And then the Advocate General said that still we have to try him, even if he has admitted his guilt, because what he did is against the Queen, and then he is liable for his severe punishment. But the judge, who was very respectful to Mahatma Gandhi, said that we need not try you. But what do you want to say on the sentence to be imposed on you? He gave a small speech for about 5 minutes and there gave a little note, which is about 2-3 pages, to the judge. Where he says that whatever he is saying is for the benefit of his countrymen. He says initially, without the knowledge of the servitude of the people in South Africa and in India, he was actually working for the British government in helping them. But he realizes that the colonial activity is detrimental to the interests of his countrymen. And whatever he says might be hurting the Queen, but that is his duty. And he calls section 124A as the prince amongst the political sections of the IPC. This is a phrase that was being used by the Supreme Court in later judgments which dealt with the aspect of sedition. The judge asks him as to what do you think should be the sentence. Then Mahatma Gandhi tells him that it is for you to decide what should be the sentence. I would not have any objection even if we send him for life. The judge says that Tilak was sent to 6 years, so you will impose the same sentence on you. And he acknowledges, he says, yes, I have no problem at all. And then he goes to jail. Sedition in this case would be important because even in Mahatma Gandhi's case, the tracking rule was followed. The test that was applied by the court was that whatever Mahatma Gandhi wrote showed disloyalty to the Queen. As to whether there was any consequence of the speech made by Mahatma Gandhi was not relevant at all, it was not taken into account at that point of time when he was tried in the 1920s. The question of including sedition in our constitution as a restriction in 1902 came up for discussion in the Constituent Assembly. There were a few objections when the proposal was made by Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel that sedition should be there as a restriction because they were anticipating trouble even free India. People said that after having undergone so much of problem at the hands of the British, we really need sedition as a restriction. But ultimately, it was decided that sedition will not be there. So they excluded the sedition. The discussion at that point of time, which evoked the response of Ambedkar, was this. The right in the United States of fundamental right of speech, though we don't call it fundamental, the right of speech is unlimited, has no bounds, whereas we are placing certain restrictions in Article 19 by putting in security of state, etc. Ambedkar said that it's a wrong understanding of people that there are no restrictions that are placed on the fundamental right of speech, though First Amendment says that no law shall be made curtailing the freedom of speech. Because on the basis of the law that was developed by the Supreme Court in judgments like Hitler versus New York, etc., in a judgment, Justice Hughes said that there are exceptions to a right of free speech. Those exceptions are security of state, decency, and immorality. These are certain rights, certain exceptions which would come into play for curtailing freedom of speech, because this is what the court said and this is what is being followed even now. So when Ambedkar said that even in US the freedom of speech is not curtailed, you would see the exceptions that are coming in regarding security of state, morality and decency, etc. in the constitution. To start with, it was only security of state and there was no public order. Public order came by the 42nd Amendment, the First Amendment. The First Amendment had come in because of one judgment of the Supreme Court. The judgment of the Supreme Court was in Ramesh Thapar's case when a case came from Madras where there was a vernacular newspaper which was sought to be stopped by the administration saying that this is against the authority of the government. And the justification that was given by the government was that public order would be affected if we permit publication of this material by the newspaper from Madras. Then the judgment of the Supreme Court said that the restriction that can be placed is only in the interest of security of state and not public order. Public order being a larger principle, which is not equivalent to security of state. This cannot be done. And then they passed an order in favor of the person who went to court. Then came the need for making an amendment to the Constitution, and that's how the First Amendment came, where the public order was included as a restriction on fundamental right of speech. The inclusion of public order was again a subject matter of certain cases that were tried by court later. One, Section 124A was challenged in the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court had occasion to deal with this not only on its own, but also on two judgments that came from two high courts taking a diverse opinion. The Allahabad High Court struck off Section 124A as being the validity of the Constitution. And another High Court against the Punjab and Haryana High Court, which upheld the validity of it, of this provision. Both these cases were brought to the Supreme Court, and the constitutional validity of 124A was upheld by the Supreme Court, in which they followed this imminent lawlessness. They said mere disaffection or disloyalty to the government would not be sufficient to attract 124A, and the person cannot be punished under that for showing his dissent, and cannot try him for a sedition. We must have seen IPC, sedition carries imprisonment for life, unlike other offences in 153A, 153B and 295A, where the sentences are much, much lesser. That is disturbing the tranquility of the society and then inciting people against the religion, even for that it is only 3 years. And there is a recommendation made by the Law Commission saying that the sentence has to be brought down and then even the section also has to be modified in a consultation paper which was issued recently. The Supreme Court said that it might be very difficult to declare this 124A to be unconstitutional because there might be some situations where this power can be invoked by the government, but it should not be used for all purposes. Whenever there is some comment made against the people in power, you cannot use 124A to stifle dissent. This is what the court said. Even Section 295A also was challenged, and the challenge was turned down in Ramagavaruvaya. These provisions having been upheld by the Supreme Court, the position as it continues is that you have a freedom of speech and expression. I should tell you about expression because expression is something which people don't really concentrate upon. Everybody thinks only of speech. What is the what are the categories of speeches which are guaranteed under 191A? If you go back, it's not only a right to speak, but right to receive information is also part of right to speech. All of you are sitting here, and I'm speaking. Whether you have a right to receive information, I have a right to disseminate information. your 19(1)A has this right also imbibed into the right. So you have a right to receive information, a right to spread information. All these are part of the right. And insofar as expression is concerned, how do you express yourself? Expression need not be by speaking. Expression need not be by words. It can be in so many ways. Expression can be by way of art. Expression can be by way of producing a movie. Expression can be otherwise. Otherwise is what I'm going to speak about. In the case filed by National Legal Service Authority on behalf of transgenders, this is K.S. Radhakrishnan passed a judgment recognizing their rights. And he put on the higher claim of Article 19(1)A saying that every individual in this country has a right to express his sexuality. So if my sexuality is that I'm a transgender or I'm a gay, so I have a right to express it. So all these years or centuries, it's been so happening that they have been suffering a social stigma for what they were, and they were not accepted by the society, and they were almost treated as criminals. The judgment of the Supreme Court has come in very handy, where the provision in the IPC has been struck down. So at least there is some solace for persons belonging to this community of transgenders, but their rights have not yet fully been accepted by the society. Do they have a right to express themselves? They have a right. If my sexuality is different, why should I hide myself? Why should I go behind the screen and then suffer? And this is what actually leads them to feel bad and that they're not part of the society. And the numbers are so many. Cases which have come out after the judgment of the Supreme Court in Nagpur, Johar, are very interesting. This judgment of the Supreme Court has received accolades the world over. Recently, the Chief Justice of Jamaica was in Delhi, and I was asked by my Chief Justice to take him out for dinner in the evening. I was just trying to research about the person whom you are going to meet, you want to know what his ideas are. So I went to the internet and then I saw what was his interest, etc. The latest judgment that he delivered was on Aadhaar equivalent in Jamaica. He followed the dissenting opinion of Justice Chandrachud. He quoted it about 20 pages. And he said that I am in agreement with it and then I wrote the case there. Yesterday evening, when I was sitting in my office, my law clerks told me that there is a judgment of the Zimbabwe Supreme Court, which was delivered on 14th of November. And it was dealing with transgenders. They gave me a copy of the judgment. The first four pages of the judgment were the judgment of Nagpur Johar. The facts in those cases, in that case, are like this. There was a person who was dressed like a woman, and the police suspected his motives in a public street. They take him to the police station, and there they were discussing as to what his sexuality is. So they asked him to lower down his pants to see what he is, whether a man or a woman. And thereafter, they take him to the hospital for examination, make him walk because there is no transport. For two nights, the person is put in jail. And thereafter, he was booked under an act which is similar to a 1937 act, which categorizes people of transgender to crimes. And he's acquitted because he didn't commit any crime. So he goes to court and then files a petition for damages, saying that this is lowering my dignity. and I have a right to be treated there as a human being, and what they did is wrong. The case was allowed. He was given damages of about $100,000. But while deciding that case, the Zimbabwe Supreme Court refers to the judgment in L.Nageswara for the purpose of saying that a person has a right to express himself. If he wants to wear a dress as a woman, let him. That's a way of expression, and that's the freedom that has been given by the Constitution to him. And that is a sort of dissent. You are expressing dissent because you are not with the majority. You are not bothered about the majority. So you express yourself in that manner. And what other expressions can you speak about? You can speak about expressions of persons who are creative, producing movies or directing movies, which have been subject matter of discussion in a few cases in this country. To start with, we have a judgment for this lady Chatterley's lawyer. If young people might not be knowing it, but people of my age might have heard it because this was in 1950s, 60s. This was a novel which was written in a lascivious style, and this was a book which was being sold in stands in Bombay. And Mangranji Tuleshi, who was a bookseller, was tried for violating the provisions of 295A of the IPC. And the matter came to the court. A constitution judge heard this, and Justice Dretula was heading the bench. He applied a test which was almost archaic. In England, there was a test called the Higley test. That was being followed for publication of books. It says, the Higley test says that any material in the form of a book which is being published, which is being released to the public, if there is a likelihood of affecting the morality of the persons who read it, then there is cause for action against the person. This test was replaced long back in US by a test called the Roth test, which said that the contemporary community standards are to be followed. You can't think about how people would react in 2019 on the basis of what people were thinking 100 years back. The standards would change in a society. There are certain things which are acceptable today, which would not have even been thought about 50 years back or 100 years back. See, the contemporary standards test is to apply, okay, there is something pertaining to sexual activity written in a book. Do you say that it is disturbing the tranquility of the society on the basis of whatever is written there? That Roth test says that you have to look into the entire book or entire contents of the movie, if at all it is concerned with the movie, and then see what is actually the message that is being given to the public. And if at all there is some mention about certain things beyond the limit, there is no chance of any censor that can be adopted. So that was the test which he followed in so far as this book is concerned. It stood the test of time for a long period, and ultimately there was a judgment of Amik Sarkar, which the Supreme Court had occasion to look into another interesting topic of Boris Becker, the tennis star, posing nude along with his girlfriend, who is a black woman, for the purpose of promoting environment. So that was published in a book. The photograph was there, and then the photograph appeared. Whether this is indecency, so the person has to be tried. The court said no. We are not going to follow this Higley test, and slowly it has been given up. So now this Higley test is not being followed. So in so far as expression is concerned, it can be by way of films, as I said, by way of drawings. You must have heard about M.F. Hussain being tried. M.F. Hussain was tried because he painted goddesses, Hindu goddesses, not in a proper form. Whether he was expressing himself, which would have affected the society or not, was the question. For some time, I think he had run away from the country. Books being banned, courts coming to the rescue of these publishers who have been saying that, see, we are only not following the orthodox method. We are not following what the people want. but we are giving them an idea out of the way. So it is for them to accept, it is for them to read. Normally, whenever a question comes as to whether the fundamental right of speech or expression of an individual has to be protected and how it has to be balanced with the restrictions that are placed in the provision itself of 19.2 have been decided on three principles by court. One is the proximity principle, the second is the arbitrariness principle, and the third is proportionality. These are the tests that are adopted by court to find out whether the restrictions that are placed are reasonable or not. Now let us take the first restriction that can be placed under 19.2, that is security of the state. Where a restriction is placed by the government in the interest of security of the state, how is it that the court is going to react? As I told you, in US, in the 1920 stage where the communist movement was on the upsurge, courts were not willing to interfere whenever a matter of security of state was being advocated by the government. What they used to say, like in the case of Korematsu, I'll tell you about Korematsu. During the World War, the US was fighting Japan, and there were a number of Japanese citizens who settled in the US, naturalized citizens of the US. Korematsu was living in the Bay Area in California, and he was asked to make way, he was asked to get his house and go away because he had to go, he was. All the Japanese persons were to go and then live in an enclosed area. He was not supposed to live in his house. He said, how can you move me out? I have a right to live in my house. When his case was taken to the court, the court said, sorry, we can't help you because we are at war. And during the conditions of war, there's no question of your saying that we have a fundamental right of speech or fundamental right of residence, etc. That receives the background. This is another case of another Japanese person, Hirabayashi. You need not go into that. I'll tell you some interesting case which was decided by the present Chief Justice Roberts in 2010. It's called Holder versus Humanitarian Project. There were certain Sri Lankan citizens who were naturalized citizens in USA who wanted to finance the LDP. And there were other persons who were financing the Kurdish party called the KPP. It is another organization which was operating for persons in Iraq, Turkey, etc. When they wanted to finance a law which said that we will not permit finances to be given to terrorist organizations to utilize, and they said that we are not going to permit to do this. And they challenged that action before the court, ultimately the matter reached the Supreme Court. In a judgment of 6-3, what Chief Justice Roberts said was this. There were actually two points that were argued in that case. One was freedom of speech. In US, financing parties or giving donations to parties is falling under expression, right to expression and right to speech. So they said that the money that we are going to give to this party will not be utilized for terrorist activity. We have the right to finance. They can, or they are capable of using this money for education of children, of persons who have been killed in war, of other activities which are useful to the society, of families who have gone out from Sri Lanka and living in various parts of the world. They will be taken care of along with their children. Taking note of the fact that in 2005 and 6, the explosion that happened in Colombo with a 1,000-ton truck where about 200-300 people died and several hundreds injured. Chief Justice Roberts says that there is no way for the court to decide as to where this money is going. The most important thing which was decided by the US Supreme Court was this. We as judges, we do not wake up every day morning with a briefing as to what the position of the security of the state is. And when it comes to the security of the state, it is completely the lookout of the executive. They are the best persons to decide what is best in the interest of the security of state. So the court said that we have to show deference to what the state is doing, and then it showed no mercy for the plea that was made by the petitioners who went before. I don't want to speak too much of what is happening in Kashmir because it is engaging the attention of the court. Certain matters pertaining to habeas have been heard by a three-judge bench, and the three-judge bench has reserved the matter for judgment. But I will just touch upon it for the purpose of understanding the point of the curtailment of dissent of freedom of speech. What is the complaint that is being made by persons after the amendment was made to the Constitution 3 months back? The internet was shut down. Mobile phones were blocked. People were restricted to their homes. There was violation of fundamental rights which are guaranteed by the Constitution, is the complaint that is made by citizens who are there in the valley. Right now, the restrictions pertaining to mobile telephones, etc., have been lifted. But internet still continues to be a problem because the shutdown continues. When the matter was being heard, one of the judges in the bench, who was a friend of mine, was discussing with me. And he was telling me about the submissions that were made by the Solicitor General by producing a material in which the material showed that terrorism is actually spreading its tentacles to the internet. Thereafter, I went home and then my law clerks made a research for me. I asked them to look into the material as to the internet and the damages caused by the internet to the society. They gave me material which showed that 2011-12 onwards, the number of persons who have gone to Iraq and the other country, Syria, where the terrorist activity is going on, where people have been fighting against the other communities, are in thousands. There are about 8,000 people who were supposed to have gone from UK and other European countries, and many more from other countries. If I'm not wrong, I read in the newspapers that some people have gone from this state also. Some of them have returned back to UK. There's a report from UK. And nobody knows what's going to happen. The indoctrination that is done by the internet, by thousands of websites which nobody has a control upon, is something which the state has to take a look. It is for the state to decide as to whether there should be a complete shutdown of the internet or whether there should be some sort of a controlled shutdown on the basis of the situation which exists on the ground. So that's where the court has no role to play. Any right that is given by the Constitution is not unlimited. Every citizen in this country has rights. There's no doubt about it. That's what democracy is all about. But there are also duties for the citizens to ensure that there is public tranquility. So this right which we are speaking of should make way to security of the state in certain cases, depending upon the situations. Again, I'm making it clear, I'm not making a comment on Kashmir. This has also been tested by our Supreme Court in a case which arose under the Unlawful Activities Prevention Act. In the Northeast, there has been disturbance for a long period of time. And shoot at sight orders have been given to the army. Allegations of misuse by the army and this imposition of shoot at sight orders has been challenged in the Supreme Court. The court said that this is something connected to internal insurgency, which is a subject matter of a discussion and decision taken by the government. And there is no role for the court to play in this. But when it comes to public order, it's slightly different from security of the state. What is public order? How do you see this public order, the law and order, and security of the state? As I told you, Ramesh Thakur, when an argument on behalf of the government was, we are now thinking of some problem which is going to arise and public order would be disturbed. That's why we have imposed this restriction. The court said nothing, we don't have that right. Now that public order has been brought into 1902, how do we understand public order? Public order, again, has to be understood in the light of the Brandenburg theory, which has been accepted by the Supreme Court. That is immanence lawlessness theory. There is a judgment of the Supreme Court in 1995, which is very interesting to note. The Khalistan movement was on, and then there were a few gentlemen, Sikh gentlemen, standing on the street in Delhi, shouting pro-Khalistan slogans. Only 5-6 people who shouted for some time got tired and went home. So nobody bothered about what was shouted there, and nothing happened. The Supreme Court said, why do you want to try them under 124A? What did they do? And then there was nobody who even cared for them. Everybody was minding their own activities. I think that the public meetings in Kerala, street corner, we have somebody speaking, but I've seen a number of times, not even 10 people are there. So whatever he speaks cannot be termed a seditious activity, because it's not evoking any response from the people. There is another theory, insofar as this activity is concerned, called the spark in the powder keg theory, which means that if there is a spark in the powder keg, then there will be an explosion. So if somebody is inciting people so much that the people start from that place and start burning, etc., then that might be a case for trying a person under the restrictions that are placed pertaining to incitement of offences. Only to that extent, the court can say that, oh, this restriction will come into play, your right has to be curtailed. The curtailment of rights is normally not done for the purpose of ensuring that the rights of a person are defeated. It should be done for the purpose of maintaining the tranquility of the state. Now let us talk about defamation. You have this problem of a number of people being very sensitive to what is said against them. I appeared for the former Chief Minister of Tamil Nadu in a number of cases filed by the government against whoever was saying whatever against her. There were about 50 cases filed then, and recently I read in the newspaper 200 cases filed against Vijayakant, which the present government has withdrawn. Whatever is said by somebody is a defamation case. We are criticizing the government. That's how sensitive people are. And there are a number of cases filed like that. This defamation is no more a criminal offense, even in England, where it all started, where people used to criticize that the Queen or the Church, etc. But in our country, subject to the restrictions, 499 and 500 they still exist in the IPC. The point which I want to speak about, which would be a principle of law, is prior restraint. Can there be a prior restraint insofar as speech is concerned in the context of defamation, defaming somebody? There is a judgment of the US Supreme Court in New York versus Sullivan. There was an advertisement in the newspaper where it said that the group of black students in Illinois, where they sat on the steps of the university and they were singing a song which was not like the whites. So they were the persons who were saying that they are being harassed by the commission of the police and others. Because after they sang that song, they were put into a room, they were not given food for 2-3 days. And then there was this advertisement appearing in the Times against Sullivan, who was the, his name was not mentioned, the police. So he said that the difference is to me. I was a commissioner there and nothing of this sort happened. It was all falsehood. They were not harassed, etc. A trial was conducted. In those days, the trial was conducted in courtrooms in the US like this, where the jury is there. You have the black sitting on one side, you have the white sitting on one side, because the white supremacy was there for a very long time in the US. And in the trial, it was held that the Times newspaper has to pay $500,000 as damages for publication. And the matter was carried to the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court said that whatever has been said by a person who was pressed, who belongs to the press, against a public servant, would stand a different test, because it is the right of persons to criticize persons in office, and persons in office have a duty to take the criticism of persons in the proper spirit for the purpose of correcting themselves. So the test that is applied for rights of persons insofar as speech is concerned differs from a private person to a person in office. A person in office, unless somebody is speaking about his personal traits, about his family, etc., where he again be following the same standards of a private person, stands on a different pedestal. The Supreme Court held that Saliman doesn't have the right now to say that whatever is written against him is bad, because that was in the discharge of his official duty, and there is no question of his saying that it was being defamed. That was the start of the press breathing easy. Because if at all Times had to pay $500,000, it would have had to close down at that point of time. So the press rights have been looked into as being covered by 19(1)(a) in India. There is no doubt about it. Right to speech includes the right of the press also. But when I was talking about prior restraint is of two types. Prior restraint placed by the government itself or by law, and prior restraint placed by the court. What are we looking at when we say prior restraint? As I said, the theory right from the beginning was this: permit people to say whatever they want. If they are violating the law, they have to suffer the consequences. That's the law. That's what we're thinking forward. So when it comes to prior restraint on the part of the executive, courts normally don't interfere except in exceptional circumstances, which I told you about the security of the state, etc. Prior restraint by court. If somebody comes in and says that, see, I have been defamed, so please stop this publication, the courts would pass an injunction insofar as publication is concerned. That was dealt with by the Supreme Court, which is even ready in a case called Rajagopal, which came from Tamil Nadu. This Rajagopal was a person, actually the case pertains to an auto shanker who was involved in some murder cases, and he wanted to write his autobiography, which he is supposed to have written, given to his wife, implicating a number of police officers who were supposed to be complicit in the offenses that were committed by him. Whether he had a right to publish it or not was the question, because the police officer said that how can you do this, because he has unnecessarily brought out names, so that the book should not be published. By deciding that case and looking into the law that developed in US, which I was mentioning about just now, Justice Jeevan Reddy said that as a public servant, if you are holding an office, there is no question. How do you balance these rights? Going with the traditional view that normally you don't, it receives some sort of relaxation when it concerns the interests of persons. But is it really being followed? How many people would go to court initially to say that, oh, please pass an injunction and this person is doing this? Let us take the cases of press trials, trial by media in criminal matters, and the damage that is being caused to individual's reputation, or even something said against an individual in the newspaper, you paint somebody back, it's very difficult for the person again to get back whatever reputation is lost. There might be some errata or an addendum issued in the newspaper a week later, but people won't even see it. Insofar as that person is concerned, for his relatives, for his friends, he is gone. His reputation is gone. So there is actually what is called a duty that is imbibed in this right. I should have a right. I should be permitted to speak whatever I want. There's absolutely no doubt about it. Dissent. Dissent comes in very handy only because that improves the knowledge of the person. That improves the standards of the society also. The right to question is something which everybody has to imbibe. There's no point in accepting whatever is being told. There's no point in all of you accepting whatever I am telling you about these principles. That should only set your minds to think and then think on the opposite, think in the negative. Is this right? There might be another way of looking at it. This might not be in tune with the established norms, but otherwise, if you look at it from another angle, might be called dissent or it. That might be accepted when you speak to me later to say that you might have been wrong. I might think, yes, this principle which has been set up for all these years might be wrong. So you have a right to dissent, which has to be religiously followed by everybody. Shouldn't be cowed down by the majority, that actually gives you strength. There is a person who was the High Court, this is Charmeshwar. He was the Chief Justice of this High Court. He went to Yale last week to deliver a lecture. He was there for a seminar. And he sent me a photograph of the first page of the book Invisible Constitution, that is written by Lawrence Tribe. Lawrence Tribe wrote, "Dear Charmeshwar, for a person who had the courage to question status quo, I hope you will continue to do this." Let's see the tribute paid to the man who had been saying all the time that you should start questioning. I've heard him say so many times that there's no point in just falling in line with what people say. You start questioning. There should be a dissent. He has even written dissents in judgments also. Take the opposite view. And then only the public would have two or three views or even more. What Voltaire said comes to my mind. He said, "I despise the speech, but I will fight for its existence till my last breath." Thank you.
I stand before you as a very poor and, I dare say, lean substitute of the man who was supposed to be here, Justice Shafiq, who unfortunately is not here because of a bereavement in his family. I've been asked to give an intruding address, which is nothing more than a vote of thanks stated in a better way. But before I do that, I would, on behalf of the Kerala chapter of the Indian Law Institute, may I just announce that we are going to have another talk on 11th January 2020. I say this in advance so that you can mark your calendars. It is going to be a presentation by Sri Gopalakrishna Gandhi, and it is basically on the topic of Gandhi and death penalty. This is a colloquium to commemorate the 150th birth centenary of the Mahatma, and the speaker is none other than his grandson. The program will be moderated by Dr. Anup Surendranath, who is from the National Law University in Delhi. Now, to come to the task that I've been entrusted with, the topic for today, the freedom to express dissent. I think all of us are in agreement that when you are talking about a constitutionally guaranteed freedom of speech and expression, that freedom would be empty rhetoric if it does not carry with the essential right to express dissent. The question therefore really is, given that our freedoms are not absolute, even under the Constitution, where do we exactly draw the line? And the line that is drawn, Justice Rao has taken us through the jurisprudential basis of the evolution of the right to dissent across all countries, the United States, England, and even back home in India. The clear and present danger test, which he started with, involved in Abrams case in the US, followed by the imminent lawlessness test, I think defines the essence of the sedition law that we now have. And it was so eloquently presented, this is Rao, and we thank you sincerely for that. Because it's not very easy to compile the case laws which spread over about 200 years in the development of the law.
I also thank Mr. Rao for the time taken to come here today to deliver this lecture, because I know how busy he was. And it's despite very many schedules that he's here today with us. He was supposed to come last evening, but that got cancelled because of another function. And he's rushing back tomorrow morning for another function in Delhi in the afternoon. So, once again, sir, on behalf of the Indian Law Institute, I thank you so much for your presence. A special thanks is also due to our beloved Chief Justice, Justice Manikumar. He too was longing to be in Chennai today, because it's a weekend but he loves to go home. I don't blame him for that, but we forced him to stay back. And for that, and for accepting to stay back, I'm thankful to you, sir. I believe he is leaving later in the afternoon. You're forgetting your family. Okay, so the family is joining you in Delhi. I must also thank the brother and sister judges of this court, and as well as the former judges. This is Farooq and this is Rajana here. The senior advocates, the advocate general who was here, I think he is left. The students, the advocates, the Saturdays are a busy day for advocates, especially the litigating ones, because today is the day I know that you meet all your clients. And so, thank you for having sacrificed your professional interests, thank you for having sacrificed your financial interests, and joined us here for this function. Students from various colleges and universities, thank you for your presence here. Media personnel are also here, they're covering the event. I thank them. I thank the staff of the High Court, they've turned up in considerable numbers, the registry. But before I leave, I must thank the organizing committee, and in particular three people. Our vibrant secretary, he may not look very vibrant, Advocate Ruby Krishnan is somewhere here in the hall. He maintains a very low profile, and all of you who know him know that as well. But he has been instrumental in putting this together. He's a very meticulous person. Every notice, every letter has to be written at least 3 times by somebody or the other. Pradeep, another vibrant person, Dr. Pradeep, and Shyam, Adiyak Shyam. All three of them are responsible for what you see here today. And I must not also forget the lady who was behind the scenes. Can we have you all? There you go. She is the master secretary. Thank you all for having come here and made this function a success.